Hello everyone, so today's video we're going to talk about Lostham, and this is a guide for how to build him for Apex Arena. So Lostham is basically what I like to consider an upgraded cherry in very many ways. And for this hero in particular, I think I'm going to switch things up a bit and I'm going to talk about the class and equipment before going back to the soldiers and then finally back to his talent and skill, because I think for this hero in particular, his class and equipment influence his playstyle to a greater degree than say something like Oboro with his two different sets. So start off, first we are going to look at his class. So Lostham has two different classes, one of them will be infantry and the other one of them will be the assassin class, and the stats are as shown here. So the name's a bit different because C likes to take the lame names and the better names are usually at global, or maybe this is just from China or something, I don't know. Maybe global has the lame names as well. But as you can see here, the Sensei King, which is the infantry class, has pretty much better stats across the board except for skill. And then, well, assassin, you know, everything is worse except for the skill, which is better. And you can see on the screen, I'm running my Lostham in assassin class. As for the stones, you know, it's the usual stuff. I don't even know if I should be talking about this anymore. HP attack is always there, and then you can pick between skill and defense if you want. So I put a bit of defense because I think this hero is kind of bulky, and maybe that 30 something, 40 something defense might be worth more than 10 skill, so that's what I went with. And as for the equipment, so this will be for assassin class. We'll start off with assassin first because that's what I'm running. Lurker Sting, basically from the recent weapon banner. So this weapon allows Lostham to get +1 unit range when using a physical damage skill to enter battle when he moves less than 3 blocks. Because he has an egg again, he's basically guaranteed to move less than 3 blocks when he uses that egg again skill to get close. So in a sense, this is like Ula Bow, you know, down to the HP 5%. It's pretty much a Ula Bow for assassins. And you get a bit of crit chance, but no crit damage, no attack, no damage, no nothing. It's something, but using this weapon actually drops your kill range by a bit, I would say, in exchange for skill range. For armor, I would say it's a no-brainer. It's last rites, it's usually the option. Helmet, I would say you can pretty much run anything. I went with Flowerboon Bonnet because it combos with one of his troops, the Sensei Mercenaries. And because of his bulky nature, you know, and multiple egg against, he might get multiple opportunities to proc the heal at low health. King's Crown is nice for buffing allies. And Najot, there's a certain build where you can stack HP with Najot, which is like Azure Legend, Najot, and OLB. Not a fan of that type of build. So, but it's something you can consider, I think it's not bad. So then for accessories, you're mostly going to be looking at Twilight Star or OLB. So Twilight Star, because this hero doesn't have any pre-battle fixed damage, so it can help to get kills on other assassins. And OLB allows you to run Dark Elf Snipers, and it's also the bulkiest attack accessory out there. And for enchant-wise, you're going to be looking at Breeze pretty much all the time. You know, if you're playing the defense stacking build, you can consider Full Moon, but that is about it. And as for the infantry set, it's pretty much going to be looking like a copypasta of a Werner set, which is Stinger, Tier, Apex Boots. The armor, you know, you don't really need to run Ice Shard on this guy, unless you're really intent on killing, let's say, Elwins that don't run SSM, that kind of thing. Otherwise, you can just play Forbiddens for the additional bulkiness. And okay, so to talk about the differences between these two builds, so the assassin build is going to be better at weaving in and out of the fights because you get to hit from further away due to your bonus range from the bow, whereas for the assassin, I mean the infantry class, ironically it's better at performing the assassin role because it has more raw damage, and having Apex Boots allows you to actually enter the fight easier, but it's harder for him to get out of the fight because you're nearer to the enemy when you attack. So that's the main difference between these two sets, I would say. Also, the assassin set will be tankier against anything that doesn't have pre-battle fixed damage, so that's another thing to consider. Whereas assassin, because the infantry set is better at sniping targets. The infantry is just like a glass cannon kind of build. And even though I say glass cannon, the fact that he has sensi mercenaries means that he can actually tank a few things, just not as good as the assassin set. Because, you know, last ride and a jot, or OLB, that kind of thing. Well, we're on the topic of soldiers. He does have a few good troops. And sensi mercenary is what you're going to be running 90% of the time, I would say, regardless of which class you're running. Although assassin class is a range unit and sensis are melee units, he does have a way of getting around it. Other than that, if you want to play for sniping targets, you're probably better off picking a range unit, especially at lower stars. So you'll probably be picking Faceless most of the time. If you're running OLB, Dark Elf Snipers become a much better option. Shinobis can be used if you want to kill things with 20% revives like Lucretia or Indomitable units. And finally, there's Hoplites if you for some reason need to tank any kind of cavalry units. So yeah, that about rounds it out for the troop. Okay, so we can finally get back into the actual hero. So let's go through the talent first. Dune Hunt. Sounds lame as hell. I know Glover has or at least Wiki Greaser has a much better name. And when there's an enemy unit within 2 blocks, attack defense and skill increases by 30%, and this unit attacks are not affected by melee damage reduction. Firstly, I just want to point out that there's literally no point of having this clause. There's no reason to have this being bound by the within 2 blocks clauses, because if someone is attacking you at melee, they have to be next to you, I would presume. So they could have just started off the talent by saying this unit does not suffer from melee damage penalty or reduction, but they decided to put it here for no reason. As for the actual talent itself, so these 2 blocks will scale up to 3 blocks at 5 stars and above, and the stat increase scales up to 20% at 6 stars. So pretty straightforward, if you are near someone, you get more stats. Then for the second part of his talent, the hero can move an additional 2 blocks after attacking, so similar to Roundabout, and can also cast Claw once after taking action. When used on a defensive terrain or a unit, applies the displacement effect to himself, in case it wasn't specific, pulls you to the target side. And this displacement effect ignores immunity when displacing the caster movement method is regarded as flying. And it has a cooldown of 3 turns, which scales up to 2 turns at 6 stars. So at 4 and 5 stars, it stays at 3 turns, unfortunately. So this hero gets a pretty big power spike at both 5 and 6 stars. And for this part of the talent, so you know, the move 2 blocks after attacking, and then you cast Claw. The Claw itself is similar to his actual Act Against skill. It is 4 blocks range, and you target a defensive terrain or a unit. So when it says ignores immunity, it's mostly for things like your own Landius, because Landius has a displacement immunity aura, and you can block friendly displacements in the case of Angelina. So I guess it's just there for that reason. And then when displacing, the caster movement is regarded as flight. So this allows him to fly across terrain that usually he wouldn't be able to, but he still can't land on top of the terrain. So yeah, just take note of that. As for his skills, the 3 skills that I've equipped right here are his so-called signature skills. And as for his basic skills, you'll mostly be considering probably something like Airslash maybe against tankless comps. It's a bit better than Quicksand Devour. And that's pretty much it, I think. Maybe some games you might want to consider Sunslash, but it being a melee skill means that it's not particularly great. And you know, let's talk about Grapnel. It's basically Claw, but you use it to initiate instead of retreating. It's basically the exact same skill as his talent, but this one has a flat cooldown of 2 rounds. Thankfully, it doesn't scale with his star level. And you know, I'm not gonna read this, it's the exact same thing. Instead of you move 2 blocks and hook backwards, this one is you hook forwards and then you move 2 blocks. And this is the main reason why the bow is a good item for Lostham, because when you move 2 additional blocks, you're basically guaranteed to proc the scepter effect of the bow. As for his 3C skill, It is a 3-round cooldown physical damage and has 2 blocks range. First off, it has a passive that gives Lostham 15% increased damage and plus 1 counter attack range for 1 turn if this unit enters on defensive terrain. So this unit plays around quite heavily based around defensive terrain. So naturally, this hero is going to be much better on maps like Windy Outpost and Gemini Bridge compared to the Sky map and Boat map. I don't actually know the actual names for those maps, I just call it Sky and Boat. And as for the actual attack itself, it is a 1.6 time damage with bonus crit chance of 30%. And melee soldiers will also attack, so you can do the maximum range even when you're equipped with Sensei Mercenaries. And if the skill is higher than the enemy is stunned before battle for 1 turn, and this stun cannot be dispelled. After battle, restores HP by an amount equal to 30% of the damage dealt. So, I don't know about you guys, but does this skill not remind you of Cherry's 3C? It's almost the exact same shit. Decent multiplier, undispellable stun, heals you after battle, and well, the cooldown is different because that one has a long cooldown if you miss the kill. And this one is a flat 3 rounds cooldown that is that benefits from him having an against skill to cycle it down even further. But yeah, other than the fact that this is ranged skill, this is almost completely identical to Cherry's 3C. And as for his Ignore Guard skill, it is a 2 blocks attack as well, City of 3 rounds. Deals 1.3 times damage that ignores guard, and after dealing damage, the enemy's mobility decreases by 2 for 1 turn, cannot be dispelled. So this is basically Lostham's Shadow Raid. It has the exact same multiplier, but it has an additional bonus of dropping their mobility down by 2. So in case you can't kill them, you cripple them for a little bit. So yeah, it's kind of there just in case. So the one thing to note about this skill is that it's a 2 range skill, and it does not specify that melee troops will attack with Lostham as well. So if you are carrying Sensei Mercenaries, and you're equipped with the bow, you can only ignore guard at 2 range if you want your troops to attack. If you attack with at 3 range with Sensis, only Lostham will attack. And on the flip side, if you want to ignore guard at 3 range with this skill, you need to bring ranged troops. So either Dark Elf or Faceless or Shinobi. So if you're playing infantry class, then it's the same thing because your hero attacks at 2 range but your troops don't. So you still need a ranged troop to attack at 2 range with Crystal Stinger. So yeah, that's it for the skills, I guess. So just gonna do a little bit of small demo after this. Okay, so this is just to show a little bit how Lostham hook and his bow weapon works. So you know, just gotta do this. And you can see this is a cliff terrain, so normally lander units can't on it, although you can't really see much here. Yeah, you see this unit is usually not accessible for foot units, but because the hook changes his unit movement to flying, he gets to do this. Then, well, you click his skills and then you can see his skills are now 3 range. And this thing is basically always active after you move because the bow requires you to move less than 3 blocks, which you always be less than 3. So, you know, just do this. And then on the return trip, you can see here, he actually cannot land onto the terrain. He'll get stuck before that. So yeah, that's basically it. So you just need to know that you can hook through the cliff and you know certain things like, I forgot what it's called, the tower, you know, the one like on desert map and on sky map. So you can hook through those but not onto those. And then I guess I can show one more thing is that you cannot hook through units even though you're flying. So I can fly across a tower, but I can't fly across a midget. So yeah, so yep, that's it for the demo. So thank you guys for watching. I'll see you guys in the next video.